Hey everybody. So in this video, I want to do something a little bit different. I want to formalize and point out a framing around a concept that I've noticed for a while now, but I haven't even until myself formalized it until recently. And the concept is that there's a literal schism when it comes to the math of AI overall, and Schism has massive ramifications overall as to where you believe AI will go, how far it will progress, how far it can progress, how far we have progressed, etc. And that schism all boils down to the math fundamentally. And I find these two research papers here that are a good representation of this schism overall, right? And then this first one is called Memoria, a scalable agentic memory framework for personalized conversational AI. And then the second one is called A Geometric Theory of Cognition. And then these two research papers, published on December 14th and December 13th, 2025, they are diametrically opposed to each other. is the bottom line that I want to dive into within this video. They take diametrically opposed viewpoints essentially, and the math isn't congruent with each other, right? And then so this Memoria is, they pointed out, a scalable agentic memory framework for personalized conversational AI. And then essentially what they do in this instance is they create a graph-based memory for agentic LLM models, right? And then so they break it down and they make it pretty clear that there's a difference. So you have episodic memory and parametric memory, and then their proposed methodology is to overcome limitations inherent in stateless LLM chat sessions, particularly their inability to retain memory across sessions, personalized responses, or maintain coherent conversations over time. We propose Moria, a modular Python-based library engineered to furnish LLMs with structured and persistent memory. Memoria operates as an enhancement layer, integrating seamlessly into any LLM, etc., etc. But then, so it's a structured conversation history with a database, right? And it's they utilize some math in order to create and have this personalization database is the bottom line. But the system architecture is 100% based off of a database, right? And here it is, and then all of it gets stored, and then all of it gets stored into a traditional database. So this is like traditional recall, exactly as you would expect. And this is like what like 99% of people think of when they think when I think they think of these things overall, that this is how it works overall, right? But then we take a look at this research paper, A Geometric Theory of Cognition. And then so the abstract of this research paper is that human cognition spans perception, memory, intuitive judgment, deliberative reasoning, action selection, and social inference. Yet these capacities are often explained through distinct computational theories. Here, we present a unified mathematical framework in which diverse cognitive processes emerge from a single geometric principle. We represent the cognitive state as a point on a differentiable manifold endowed with a learned Riemannian metric that encodes representational constraints, computational costs, and structural relations among cognitive variables. And so this is all essentially it's all based off of Riemannian geometry. And then essentially what they're doing and what they're saying is that the cognitive potential of a structure of an of a latent space of a latent is it has to pay a cognitive cost, and then in that cognitive cost it then becomes that is coupled with the problem, and then you get a task-aligned optimum that always occurs. And then so all of this essentially aligns to create essentially a geometry of how memory, recall, cognition, etc., all come together, right? And then so under this framework, there's no database. So how does under this geometric theory of cognition, how does memory work? So memory works exactly how it would work within how we think it works within the human mind, right? Which would essentially be that it's a pattern. Like when you remember something, you're remembering like a pattern of space and time, a scent. Is like the patterns of that recall are the same patterns of the smell of your childhood, and then so you remember that, right? And that's what triggers the recall of that memory. And it's a pattern recall, and that's why memory isn't one static, right? And it's not like you can't be it's not reliable overall, because that reconstruction can change and be manipulated, etc. Over time, right? And but it's just constant reconstructions, essentially utilizing these types of equations. But so this and this, these are very different concepts mathematically overall. That they're literally two different concepts, right? Like two mass of intelligence overall is what I want to highlight and dive into within this. And so over the last few years, I've noticed something strange. If you talk to engineers building AI systems, they tend to converge on one kind of solution. If you talk to mathematicians thinking deeply about cognition, they converge on something entirely different. Both groups are intelligent, both groups are converging, but they're converging to different mathematical worlds, either this knowledge graph world or this geometric world. And then so, and almost no one's willing to admit out loud that these aren't congruent. One of these is wrong. And then so this piece is me saying it out loud. And then so the first math is intelligence as retrieval. And then so most modern agentic memory systems, including recent well-written research, share the same underlying assumptions. Memory is something that you store, this memoria, right? That you log conversations, you extract facts, you embed them into vectors, you retrieve the top k closest items using Euclidean or cosine similarity, you apply heuristics for recency, you re-inject those items into a prompt, then the language models reason after retrieval. That's literally what this method is doing, right? Their proposed methodology is utilizing all of those steps that I just laid out here, right? And then this approach works, it scales, it's interpretable, and it fits cleanly into databases, vector stores, and production pipelines. It's also very clearly an engineering abstraction. This is an engineer's dream as to how these systems work. It's not a criticism, it's just a description of it. And then, but it's important to say what this math cannot express. What retrieval math can't describe, retrieval-based memory systems can't naturally represent why some beliefs are harder to change than others, why habits form and resist updates, why some thoughts feel expensive, why certain cognitive shifts take time even when information is present, why reasoning paths have inertia, and why the same information produces different effects depending on prior experience. These aren't edge cases, these are the core phenomenology of cognition. And then so within this, right, all of these things are what cognition is. And then so retrieval math can't explain or account for cognition, which leads us to the second math. And then the second math is intelligence and motion, this a geometric theory of cognition. And then so if you follow mathematicians long enough, especially those working in geometry, physics, or information theory, they tend to converge on a very different framing. Not memory as a storage, but cognition as movement. And then, so in this view, an internal state evolves continuously in time. Behavior is a trajectory and not a lookup. Learning reshapes the space itself. And memory is not what you retrieve, it's what constrains where you can easily go. Once you demand coordinate invariance, effort, and path dependence, something inevitable happens. You're forced into geometry, not Euclidean geometry, but Riemannian geometry, as outlined here. And then so the gradient alone is not enough. you must specify a metric, a notion of how hard it is to move in each direction. And then this single shift explains fast versus slow thinking, habit versus deliberation, belief inertia, memory itself as to like how it works cognitively, and then reasoning, right? Like, and then so no canon is required, no retrieval steps exist, time is intrinsic within the process, memory's not recalled, it's felt. And then so these two maths are not the same thing. This is not congruent, like they're not equal and they're not congruent. They're not two implementations of the same idea. They're not levels of abstraction, and they're not interchangeable. But we call both of these AI, right? They make a different ontological claim about what intelligence is. Like this is a complete, like this, the end result of this is a completely different theory of physics than this. And then the starting point of this is a completely different starting point, ge like mathematically, than this, right? This is based off of 2000 plus year old math and the progression of that math from Euclid to Newton to now. This is 15 year old math, flat out. And then one treats intelligence like a database with heuristics, the other in intelligence like physics. And then you can combine them in systems, and many do, but combining them does not make them equivalent. And then pretending that they're the same hides the real questions. And then so why does this schism exist? The divide is historical and not accidental. Engineers inherited databases, indexing, search, scalability, and auditability. Whereas mathematicians inherited variational principles, invariance, dynamics, geometry, and constraint-driven behavior. Both traditions are valid, and they solve different problems. But the mistake is assuming that one can replace the other. And then so why convergence matters? I've seen many people independently arrive at the same geometric conclusion that you just replace the gradient with a Riemannian one. I point this out because, like, I've seen what this talks about, this Riemannian approach within this research paper a lot. Like, in a lot of instances, like hyperbolic computing, like in a lot of instances, right? And then it's when you have like hundreds or thousands of mathematicians that are they always like just circle around this. Like, there's something within that to me, right? They don't coordinate with each other. They don't cite each other. They don't even use the same language. But that kind of convergence usually means that there's something important is being touched, right? And it doesn't prove that the theory is correct, but it does suggest necessity. And then when many independent thinkers converge on the same structure under different constraints, it usually means that the structure is not arbitrary. And then so to me, moving forward with this, I'm not interested in dismissing retrieval-based memory system. Like, this has use, right? There's every system that I build is a mix of this plus this. And then they're useful, they're necessary, and they're deployable, but they're not a theory of cognition. They're scaffolding. Like, this is just pure scaffolding around a model, right? That's all it is and never will be. But what interests me is the question that we keep avoiding. What happens when memory is geometry and not content? What happens when time is intrinsic and not scheduled? And then what happens when intelligence is a movement and not lookup? Those questions sit in the gaps between disciplines, and ideas that live in those gaps always take longer to be accepted. It doesn't make them wrong, usually just makes them uncomfortable. So, final thought, there are two maths of intelligence emerging right now. One is winning in benchmarks. Other keeps reappearing whenever people stop optimizing and start thinking. I don't think we're wrong to notice a schism. I think we're late naming it. And I think the first step within that is to just name it and discuss it and talk about it overall, right? And then so again, like, it's important, like, to notate, like when it comes to cognition, when it comes to AI, as we're talking about within this, one of these frameworks is wrong. Which one is the actual framework for cognition? I mean, to me, Like the most recent one that is actually like a description of cognition seems to be the most correct one to me. Like, and that's the one that like flat out, like I do have bias towards this one, right? Like I have self-admittedly all day long. I think this one is wrong. Like, I don't think that this one is, I think this one is exactly as I talk about it, right? Like a snapshot through a camera lens, like the incorrect assumption, like a based off of if I were to create my assumptions of the universe 2,000 plus years ago and then go from there, which would make complete sense 2,000 plus years ago, but if I'm like taking everything that I know within that I've learned within the last 2,000 years, I arrive at this, and then so this seems to be a better description of how the universe actually operates as we are today overall. And then so that's how I look at these things overall. I'll leave a link to this article as well as these two papers here. And then if you like this type of content overall, please like and subscribe. Thank you very much.